it's Larry here of Xbox Live's Major Nelson. Welcome to the show, number 633. Jeff couldn't be here. He's over in France. I don't know what he's doing over there, but he said he can't be there. So I said, who can I get? Who can I get to sit in for Jeff? And I got Phil Spencer. Hi, Phil.
I'm subbing in for Jeff today.
You're subbing in for Jeff.
I love that. Jeff's much better at this than I am.
He's over in, I think he's overseas. He's working on upcoming, because Crackdown comes out in a few weeks.
It does. I'm looking forward to that.
You've been playing it. I know you've played it quite a bit. I haven't had a chance to play one of the latest builds, but it's feeling good, right?
Feels like Crackdown.
Feels like Crackdown, right?
I think, which is what I wanted us to get to. And, you know, for Crackdown, for people who haven't played, it's been a while since I kind of ignore version 2. I'll say version 1 launched.
Sure.
And
now you worked on that a little bit.
I did.
Yeah.
Car Wars, codename with Dave Jones was the name of it. It was a fun title to work on. You know, we launched it obviously with the Halo beta on
right.
it. And I think that kind of gave a skeptical view on how this was going to turn out.
But I remember that because everyone was like, oh, this is not going to be really good because it's in, you know,
that's right.
You're putting it on the beta. And then everybody got in like, holy cow, wait
yeah.
a minute.
Yeah. I loved it. I played a ton of it. I thought just the feeling, the physics, the movement of the agent, the leveling, I thought was awesome.
Right.
So when I was playing this one, you know, it's probably a year ago where I was spending a little more time with it. And the agent to me just didn't feel right. But I say it feels like Crackdown, not to downplay it. Crackdown is what it is, right? It's
right.
not meant to be. It's not a novel.
Right.
It's not hyper realistic graphics.
Right.
You know, I hear people say, hey, well, why does it look like that? Well, because that's how Crackdown looks.
Right.
And if we were going to make it look different, it wouldn't be Crackdown.
Wouldn't be Crackdown.
So it doesn't take itself too seriously.
Yep.
I think Terry Crews in the game was an awesome choice.
Yep.
And it kind of fits with the overall motif of the game. And I love it because it feels kind of like old school mayhem game. You're going to play with your friend. You're right. going to have a good time.
Blow stuff up.
That's right.
A lot of stuff.
And a lot of leveling, a lot of collecting. And I like that motion of the game. It's something I have fun with. Not that we build games for me.
Right.
But I just want people to go.
We kind of do.
It's not true. But I just want people to go into it. It's Crackdown.
Yeah.
So if you don't like Crackdown, you're probably not going to like this game. If you love Crackdown, I think you will like this game.
Yeah, and I know that I was just talking to the team who's working on it. They've got some cool stuff. Over the next few weeks, you'll start hearing more and more as we build, you know, get up to launch.
Yeah.
But they were showing me some of the tech behind, you know, the cloud-based stuff, and it's kind of cool.
Yeah, you know, that I thought we overplayed at the launch of the game for some not necessarily the right reasons. Cloud was the game. And
right.
it's got to be game first before it's the how we build it.
Right.
People don't care as much about how we build something.
Sure.
They care about what we build. So tone that language down. I think in the end, we're really happy with the tech that we invested in so many years ago.
Right.
With Cloud Gen and Dave and the stuff to make this work. So I feel really good about the use of the cloud and the use of the technology in Azure and stuff to make this game play the way it plays. And I think people who are interested in that will find some of the backstory stuff that we do on that after the game is out to be really great. I'll say another thing I really love is just seeing Joe Staten really stepping in.
Oh, Joe, yeah.
You know, it's obviously known Joe since back when he was at Bungie. And he's become such a spokesperson for this game.
Yeah.
I think it's just awesome to see him playing a more public role in one of our games. And I think it's great.
Yeah, I'm going to have him on the show when we get closer to launch.
He's really great at talking about the game.
I mean,
he has such a sensibility for how games are built and the hooks and it's really, I have a good time. Sometimes when you're in the publishing organization, you're working on a lot of different things. It's not always easy to find something that's yours and you can kind of be the out front person. But I think he's turned out to be the person who's out in front of that game in a very public way. And I think that's great.
Yeah, it's funny. Jeff isn't here as we were just talking. He's
overseas, yeah.
But he just texted me. I'm going to tell the story. He's going to kill me. He says, don't judge me. I'm at Starbucks. So he's in France at a Starbucks.
We should all judge him.
So
even in Seattle.
At Jeff Rubenstein, you can hit him up on Twitter. They can find you on Twitter too.
They can, Xbox P3. Yeah, I've been a little less active on Twitter lately. I don't really like that I'm less active. I have to figure out how to engage more. The stream goes, I mean, how do you do it? Like
it's hard because it's, you know, I wake up in the morning. You're an early riser, right?
Yeah.
You're an early riser. I'm an early riser. I check it out, see what's going on and reply to a few things because there's a lot of chatter that happens when you're offline. I mean,
that's
just the way it is. It's tough to keep up with. And it's one of those things. You'll notice like on the weekends, I'm kind of more quiet
because
it's like, oh man, I just want to spend some time.
You should with your family.
With my ladies. But it's hard to do, but it's also really exciting and fun. fun because, I mean, you know this, we've been doing, you and I have been doing this for a long time. It's the excitement you get out of people that just love the product,
yeah,
love our games, yeah, and love gaming.
Yeah.
It's really gets me going. So that's what it does.
I used to just love when it was a smaller community. Not that it, that's what my goal is anymore, but I almost used it as kind of an AMA type thing.
Right.
And I always get a lot of knowledge out of what people are asking. Like,
right.
I get a lot of like, where are people's questions?
Right.
What are they worried
What's going
about?
On
what
here?
They,
yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And it's more difficult to do. That's on me. Like, the community's not doing anything wrong. But I gotta. It's been, I'd say, a month or two since I was in that mode on Twitter, and I want to do that because that feedback from the community is great. I'm doing a little more of that on Xbox Live now.
Yeah.
Because it's just sometimes a little bit easier when I'm online and somebody wants to play something or just somebody wants to.
What did we play last? You and I did Forza. Oh, we played some Forza a few. You know, when that
Horizon,
came out.
Yeah.
Yeah, Horizon. That was a lot of fun.
Those guys. I mean, they. They are Playground is they is magic. I mean the
yeah.
that game, the hook for me in that game is just so good.
Yeah.
And yeah, I've been playing that. You know, for we always obviously have our Game Pass commercial that we roll out every so often. It comes out of our mouths.
Right.
But I have my story, like Vermintide 2 I found in Game Pass, which funny enough for me, I mean, I get a code to every game on
sure.
Xbox.
Right.
So I had it.
But you never had a chance to look at it.
I hadn't really.
Yeah.
And then it was.
What drew you to it?
So it was in one of the Game Pass quests. And if people have been watching, we've been trying to play with these ideas of Game Pass quests where we'll build little challenges in games and you can earn Microsoft rewards.
Right.
For doing these things. And it's really as a discovery mechanism.
Right.
So I'm like, we're early on in quests. And if you're going through the flow right now, you can see that we're early on.
We're trying to figure it out.
The user interface flow is not so great. All of a sudden, this rewards app pops in your face and it's all blue. And it's like,
yeah. This
is but anyway, we're working through it. And so I sit down and I use our stuff.
Right.
And you send my feedback.
As you do.
So, yes, as I do. And the Vermintide was one of them. Like,
right.
Get to Achievements or whatever it was.
Right.
And Vermintide 2. So I said, oh, okay, I'll launch this thing. Obviously, you've heard me before tease, like, we got a lot of Warhammer and Vermintide games. Like, those guys are really prolific in
yeah.
putting out games on the platform, which is
one
great.
Way to say it.
But man, I've been playing this and I really like it. I mean, I'm kind of probably more just from my growing up, more of a fantasy than sci-fi, just in terms of my core.
I'm the absolute opposite.
Yeah. And it's like, and I respect everybody.
That's likewise. Yeah.
But so I'm like, oh, this is like 30 or 40 minute. Strike co-op strikes.
Yeah.
Like, this game makes a ton. I think they do a great job putting just hordes of enemies.
Yeah.
And I think I've saved the planet from the hordes of rat men so many times. But I have a good time because I can play with new people.
Right.
So I've been doing that. I'm trying to work through MCC Legendary with some friends of mine, which is
fun. The latest update's really nice.
It is. They've done a really good job. And
did you see that article on Kotaku last week?
Yeah. And I like the one about the kudos to 343.
Yeah, because they it came out and it just they just kept working on it over the years, frankly. And
yeah.
Better.
And I think it's awesome when we stay on things. I will say the quality of the launch wasn't where it should be.
Right.
So it's a little bit of two sides of the coin. I mean, you can't rewind time.
Right.
So once you're in a situation, I love the fact that 343 didn't lean back. They leaned in. They rolled up their sleeves. They learned from what happened.
Yep.
And then they stayed committed to the franchise and the fans, which
yeah.
I think is awesome. Obviously, we need to learn on how we actually not getting ourselves into that situation again, which I think would be fundamental.
Right. Right. I'm looking at the studios here. So last year was huge. 2018 was huge. You stood on stage at E3. You announced all the studios. I mean, I'm looking at this. It's quite the portfolio you've collected. I mean, most people collect like shoes and I don't know, they collect coins. Sometimes they've got video games up on a cabinet. You're collecting studios from around the world. Well, for us though, for the gamers, for
yeah,
everybody.
The 2018 was a fun year. But I mean, we've been on this journey now for a while.
Yeah.
And you know, what I'd say is this is my fifth year in this role.
Is it already?
I think coming up on my
fifth year. Yeah, you're right.
If I'm counting
happy
correctly.
Anniversary.
I run out of fingers at some point. But the I think in the beginning, we tried to figure out, you know, what we were about, why we were here, kind
right.
of getting back to the soul of what it means to be an Xbox
yeah.
team. And then we put on our hats and said, okay, let's figure out a strategy for why we're going to be in this space. We don't want to just duplicate what somebody else is doing. If somebody else is doing a great job being what they are,
right,
we should have a unique reason to be in this industry.
And what's and have a value of something that is valuable to customers that can't get anywhere else.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Whether that's hardware differentiation, whether it's, and at the same time we were doing all that work, we were working on things like, well, we got to get our hardware in a better position. Yep. I love the S and the X and where they sit today. And I think we learned a lot about that. But I would look, and I would say at the end of 2017, beginning of 2018, we had really solidified the strategy, our longer term strategy, say decade long strategy for what we're trying to do. And it's really about putting the gamer at the center of everything. Play the games that you want to play on the devices you want to play them on with your friends, wherever they are. And you should be able to cross play with anybody. You should be able to, as much as we can, we're going to bring our content to you wherever you are. And that means we need to have a critically successful console ecosystem. We've got to be great on PC, and eventually we want to be great anywhere that somebody wants to play one of our games or one of our partners' games. And when I looked at 2018, because I'm just obviously early in 2019, I try to get my head around like, well, okay, what's this year about?
What's next? Yeah.
And I think what I loved about 2018, and you know this, it's not something we talked about in the press a ton, but this time last year we did a really big reorg.
Right.
Where we brought in a couple of new leaders because we had a real good vision on where we wanted to go, or at least we had solidified that.
Came up with the idea, now you have to put everybody in place to execute that
plan. That's exactly right. And what I'd say, what I love the most about 2018 is I feel like we got the right teams together. And I mean that teams in kind of the plural. Some of those were added, as you said, like six new studios, adding the seventh with the initiative, and they're doing a great job hiring. And I think now we're in execution mode. Like I look at 2019 and where we're going with future consoles, all this X Cloud coming to PC, I think in a much bigger way this year, doing some things that we've been talking about for a while for real on PC this year. And this is a year where it's not strategery. It's roll up our sleeves and show.
Yeah.
And I love that. I love the studio acquisitions as part of that. I love the team as it's set up right now and our leadership team and how they're showing up, the different leaders, some new, some that have been around for a long time. And I think everybody sees it now that this is the year, okay, it's going to be, this is now it's go time.
Yeah. But I also want to point out is that we talked about the studios specifically. Some of them are going to have some stuff this year and some of them, like maybe the initiative won't have it for a little while.
That's right. Right?
So it's not like we're going to have all 12 studios. Here's all the new stuff. You're going to see it's rolling. That's just the way it works.
Yeah. The real goal with the studios for me is to get a large enough studio base where we can delight and surprise ourselves and our fans with games. And it's on a regular cadence. So we're not always pinched to say, okay, well, what can we announce? Now we can say, what do we have to announce? And which of these things do we actually want to announce?
Right.
And what do we want to let sit and percolate a little longer? And you know this, like it's been a while since we were in that position with our internal studios.
Yeah.
And I feel really good about that. As Matt Booty and I are sitting down and looking at all the different things that the teams are working on, it's just the kind of capability that we have now as a first party organization. I do think it'll continue to get bigger, but what we have right now is just so different than the position we've been in the last 5 years, which is awesome.
Without a doubt. I mean, just even the games alone. Obviously, people think about games with Compulsion and Ninja Theory. I mean, it's quite amazing. And I know you've looked at the pipeline and you're excited about the pipeline.
I am. I mean, one of the cool things was Obsidian, right? And seeing their announce at the Game Awards.
Right.
I've seen what Ninja Theory is working on next and what their pipeline
looks
like.
I'm dying to go out there to that studio. I know you went out a little while ago to visit.
Yeah, we were there in November.
I'm dying to go out to Ninja Theory because, I mean, that game, because as an audio nerd, that game blew my mind.
Oh, it's fantastic. I'm actually going back and truth be told, I hadn't finished it. I was kind of right at the second to last chapter.
Right.
And I got stuck in some other things. So literally yesterday, I think I'll finish it probably today. I'm on the last chapter and I've got, you put the headphones
on. We're talking about Hellblade. And Hellblade. If you haven't played it.
On Game Pass.
It's on Game Pass.
It is. the collection of things that the teams, that the studios that have come together. I was out at Rare at the same time, went to Rare Playground, saw what Playground's working on next. I saw what Rare's working on next and their continued growth and success with Sea of Thieves.
Yeah, everyone's streaming that now. Did you see that?
It is. I mean, it's such a fun game, a communal game. You and I have played,
we played it.
And
remember, we're running away from those guys, and you're like, drop the sail. Yeah. Go around the other side of the island.
Well, I always laugh when people come to me about Sea of Thieves. They say, oh, it's the most tranquil, calming game. I'm like, you have not played the same Sea of Thieves that I have.
No.
Because when I'm playing, I'm always looking at the horizon. Is that a sail? Is that a sail?
Right.
It can be one of the most kind of on edge games, but Rare's done a really nice job in learning from the community. You know, I get the feedback from some, man, if they did just ship this game when they launched. I don't think people understand the role that the community has played in what Sea of Thieves has become.
Right.
And that feedback loop, I mean, I guess we could have just sat in beta for 9 months or whatever. I'm not sure what that would have meant.
Right.
But we said even before we launched that the gamer's voice is going to play a big role in how we grow this game.
Yeah.
And that's not done, right? Yeah. When we look at where this is going, some of the stuff announced, some of the stuff unannounced, I think this is something that's long for us. Like we're big believers in the Sea of Thieves and where it's going to go. And it's great to see Joe and the team continue to innovate there.
Yeah, I had them on. We did when we were down at the event in Mexico City at XO. I had those guys on, and I'm going to have Joe Neat, the executive. I think I'll have him on the show in a couple weeks.
Yeah,
To talk about what they're working on. But yeah, they just have such a great job over there. So yeah, you've been playing a lot of games that have been announced and haven't been announced.
Yeah, that's always when I go dark on. Live, it's usually
that's why he's not tweeting, folks, because he's too busy playing those unannounced games.
Dev kit. Because it's showing up in the last 2 to 3 months when something's going to ship and giving some feedback is not always the most productive thing for a team.
Yeah.
So
it can derail them, actually.
It can. So
Phil says he wants this. Stop the presses.
That's not what they said. It's like, just tell him we'll do it later. Getting in early, getting your hands on things. If there are things, I don't know how to put this without, like, if there are games that I have some history with,
sure,
that then, like, I might have something to say about some of the kind of core values.
And when you say history, I mean, you're as a player or maybe as somebody who was in production.
That's right.
Right? I mean, because you've played so many games, both as a regular person playing them as well as somebody who's...
Then I put my other non-regular
person. Exactly.
What have you been playing?
Assassin's Creed Odyssey.
I watched you. I don't watch you. I see the live that you're playing.
That game, I started playing in October when it launched. Then I said, okay, I got to put this.
Hey, you went away from it for a while.
Right, because I went into Red Dead.
Yeah.
And I finished Red Dead, went through Red Dead, and then I went back to it, and it just the game just got bigger and bigger and bigger. I don't understand that game, how they shipped it. It's so huge.
And you played, I remember you played a lot of Odyssey too, didn't you?
I did, yeah.
Yeah. That's the thing. I'm letting, or Origins, sorry. Play a lot of Origins. I'm letting Odyssey, I've played, I don't know, 10 hours of it.
The combat's amazing.
The team does a fantastic job. That was another one. I got to go out with Ubisoft and sit with some of the creators. I played that a year ago and played some of the other games and just talk to the teams about whether it's a game that we're marketing or somebody else marketing. I don't really care about that. But
It's a game.
It's a game. And so this one, since I played so much Origins, I don't want to burn out on it. So I'm letting it sit for a little bit. So I go back to it every once in a while. What else?
I'm playing that. I was in North Carolina last month.
Yeah.
For the Division 2.
Yeah.
So playing the new Dark Zones, and we talked about that over the past couple of weeks. So I'm playing a little bit of the Division 2 before it launches, of course.
Yeah.
You know, that's when, you know, I can do that too, Phil.
Yeah.
So I'm playing that. We're still getting into Overwatch. PUBG just shipped Vikendi, which is the new snow-covered map.
Yeah,
the snow map. So they shipped that this week. So we played that a little bit. Sea of Thieves, of course, trying to get the gang back in there. That's one thing I was telling Joe. I was like, look, I love Sea of Thieves, but when I go in the world, I kind of have to block out my calendar for an hour, an hour and a half, you know? So that's why I know they're working on the arena stuff for a little bit
tighter loop,
That's kind of what I'm focused on right now. I haven't had a chance. We'll talk about, here's the headline that everyone's going to pick up on. I haven't had a chance to check out the new, Mario on the Switch.
Not Smash Brothers.
No,
I've
got to check that out. Got to do that. But yeah, I mean, just a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And then one thing I'm really excited about, the Anthem VIP demo coming out this week.
Yeah.
Did you play the demo?
Yeah.
When we had internal access to it? A lot of fun.
It is fun.
I'm sure you gave your feedback to Casey Hudson.
Yeah. Yeah. I like Casey a lot. And even Patrick back a year and a half ago when we were looking at some stuff on that game.
Yeah.
And it's great to have Casey there. I mean, he's such a strong creative leader. It's fantastic to see him back at BioWare and doing cool things. Yeah. I mean, you play a lot. I see you online. I love the fact that, you know, I see your go-tos and then, which is awesome. And I think, it's nice to be, for both of us, I think, to be able to work in a space where kind of our hobby is our job.
And yeah, well, that's why, and you and I have talked about this a lot off the air as well as on the air, is that it's, we just love what we do. And I've been here. I think you had a nice comment to me on Twitter. In fact, when that moment you were on Twitter a few weeks ago, where I just passed 18 years here.
Congrats on that.
Thank you. Yeah. Of which 15 and a half were here at Xbox.
Yeah.
Because it's fun.
Yeah.
And we work with amazing, smart people. And you and I are blessed because we get to work with these people and you more so than me, but represent the brand to a lot of people.
Yeah. I mean, going back to like 2018, 2019, where we are, and I've done this kind of story too many times, but what I'll say today is when I sit down with the teams, and I did a couple product reviews yesterday, almost 100% of the time, the team sits down having made so much more progress on what they're working on than I would have expected.
Right.
And it's just awesome when you get to work at teams that are accelerating on their own.
Yeah. Like
they have their own belief. Yep. They have their own capability. They feel empowered.
Yep.
They know who their customer is. They know what they're trying to do.
Just focus.
That's right. And you don't, like, I sit down, I try just not to say something stupid to slow them down because they're just doing it.
Right.
And
you get out of the way.
Try to get out of the way.
Yeah.
I'd say a few years ago, it was more about alignment, more about belief. What can I do to help? Right. How do we untangle some things that maybe are tangled?
Yeah.
But it just is so, so cool. I mean, you think, and I've been in the company for a long time, and I say, okay, at some point somebody else is going to sit in this chair, and, and that's just fair.
Right.
But right now it's just so much fun.
Yeah. You know what I was thinking? I was looking at you. We're going to play a little Jeopardy.
Uh-oh.
What is 137 days and 15 hours?
I'm going to guess it's E3.
There you go. Yeah. E3. Getting ready for that.
Yeah.
I know I've been in some meetings, and you've been in a lot of meetings as well.
Yeah. You know, this is going to be a fun E3 for us. We, you know, there are obviously some news about E3 back in the fall, and we had a discussion internally of should we go big, should we save some money,
right?
You know, what does that mean? And we decided no, we're going to do our thing, and we're going to go and be as big at E3 as we've ever been. And I love that opportunity. I love the opportunity to be with our fans in the industry,
right?
And the industry conversations, it's like a revolving door in Sarah Bond's team who runs business development for us. And right now, and the third party's coming through, and what do we want to do at E3? A lot of interest. But it is going to be fun. And this team, last year we changed venue, which I think.
Oh, boy, did we. We upgraded.
We did. We did. And we're
Galen was great, but wow.
Yeah, it wasn't. I mean, not that it's the Microsoft Theater, but the Microsoft Theater is a special place. I love the location, how it's right in the center of everything.
Yeah.
And this year we're changing up a couple, as you know, things about how we're showing up at E3.
Yep.
And I think, again, in a positive way. So, you know, we've done it now for a while, this team, the team. And I love when we throw a new wrinkle in because I think it gets all of us a little bit on edge in terms of either where it is.
That's the way it was last year.
That's right.
Everyone was like, you know, the people that have been doing a lot of the folks in our events team and all the different parts have been here for a long time.
They have.
So they were like, oh, I don't know. And but it was great to see people roll their sleeves up and solve problems and get excited about the new location.
They did. And I think it was world class.
Yeah.
And I'm looking forward to this year. I'm thinking of, you know, I'm interesting on how and who we get on stage and how we kind of do that this year. And then I think it's going to be great. I think we're still going through some of the internal discussions about how much long term versus how much near term do we talk about?
Right.
You know me, I'm always more of a proponent for just being as transparent as we can be. That said, you know, if things could change or something, you don't want to head fake people and say we're doing X and then we're doing Y. But I feel really good about our plans, and we'll kind of work through those things with the larger organization. But I think it's going to be, I think the content that we'll have will be great. I think, you know, we'll talk about our future. I think we'll talk more about what the Xbox brand means to us. You know, I think rightfully most people, when they think about an Xbox, they think about a gaming console.
Yeah.
We do as well. Yep. And I love the fact that the gaming consoles play such an important role in our strategy. But at the same time, We have millions of Xbox customers who we never see on console today.
Yeah.
We see them on a phone, or we see them on a different device, or on PC. And to really continue to push this idea that you can be a member of the Xbox community, even if you're not playing your games on a console.
Yeah. Wherever you are.
Wherever you are. And we want to continue to make that possible. You can stay connected to your friends. You can stay connected to your content. One thing I'm doing, which I had a good time with when I was away over the holidays, I was playing games on xCloud.
Really?
Yeah.
So that we announced this last year, and I know that internally, I haven't had a chance to do that. I've got my devices ready to go, but
tell
me about that.
It was fun.
Be careful.
No, I was just playing. Like, yeah. I think like anything, we want to make sure we get it as right as we can.
Right.
And the best way for us to do that is to test it with us. And,
right.
I was in Hawaii for a little while,
right.
And I have my device and I'm playing, and it's cool because when I'm doing it, I'm just on Xbox Live. Like, right. I'm just getting the same toast pop-ups,
right.
Like people invited me to parties,
right.
And stuff. And like to anybody else in the service, I'm just playing.
You're just playing.
And I'm playing this
game. That's the way it should be.
That's the way it should be. That's what kind of the, so I am as much a part of the Xbox community in that context as I am when I'm sitting down in front of my X.
Regardless of what device you're on or where you are.
That's right. Yeah. And there's, you know, I'm learning a lot as I'm playing games this way. It's helping me kind of think about the experience before we get it in the hands of customers. But I think it's just, when I think it'll be, let's be clear, it's going to be years, I think, before this is the primary way that millions of people are playing.
Right.
But as sitting at a company like Microsoft with the assets we have, I think we should focus on the now, and let's go be great with the consoles we have in market now and the games that we can go build.
Yeah.
Let's think about our future in our kind of the existing spaces of console and PC, and let's go be real meaningful in those places. We got significant work to do there on PC, but I love the plan. But I think we should also have these kind of 5-10 year views on where we think things can go.
Right.
And I love the fact that we can play in all three of those horizons at the same time.
Now, I have to ask you this because your boss, the CEO of the company, for the CEO of one of the most valuable companies in the world, Satya, what's that like in his engagement with gaming? I mean, clearly you report to him, so he knows that it's valuable to the company and it's a big deal.
Yeah, I'd say for Satya Nadella, our CEO, and Amy Hood, our CFO, which are probably my two primary contacts,
right?
Incredibly supportive. And obviously, when you're going and adding even the studios that we did in the last, 8 months, you know, Amy's got to approve all that as the CFO.
The chief financial officer.
Chief finance. And I've said this before, you know, Satya looked at me on the last one, because we've closed them all now, we've closed them all, and he's like, man, we're really in on content, aren't we? Like, yes, we are. But he loves the strategy. And I think he more than anything, he trusts the team.
Now, Amy doesn't play a lot of games, does she? Was it you were telling me the story about The Division?
No, I don't think so.
Somebody was telling me this story about it. And I don't know Amy that well.
Yeah.
But somebody was telling me the story because she's our chief financial officer.
Yes.
And apparently we were talking about The Division and she said, oh, I love Division.
Yeah.
And no, not that type of Division. Yeah. Not long Division, because she's a numbers person.
Yeah, that's right. Amy pays a lot of attention. She watches streamers. She stays.
Oh, really?
Stays very connected. She's got younger kids. She doesn't have a ton of time, so she doesn't play a lot. But I think as her kids are getting into the ages where they'll be playing, she'll have that connection, which is great. Satya just, as I think for both of them, trust in the team, belief in the strategy are critical components, big supporters. You know, there are certain things where I have to work, like take Game Pass. Satya will, it's easy. He calls Game Pass the Netflix of games.
Right.
You know, I think
a lot of people do.
And it's not.
Right. Right?
And that's no disrespect to Netflix. I'm a Netflix subscriber.
Right.
I love it.
Right.
But it is fundamentally different.
Sure.
The content that we have works differently than a video thing where there's a beginning, middle, and end, and then it stops. Not all games are like that. Games last longer. Some games have business models inside of themselves.
Right.
Some of the aspects that are similar, it's been really cool just to see the uplift in gameplay. People, when they find, I saw some interesting stat, I'm sure we'll kind of publicize it at some point. Human Fall Flat is a game that's done incredibly well in Game Pass. And when we watch those players, like we say, okay, oh, here's a puzzle game that I don't know how it would have done on Xbox without the exposure of Game Pass. You can never kind of do the
right
before and after of that. But now you see, hey, we got a lot of other puzzle games that all of a sudden are becoming more popular.
Right.
And where are those players coming from?
All boats rise.
Yeah, it's actually literally, it's coming from people who the first real puzzle genre game that they played is a game like Human Fall Flat. And I think how awesome is it that we have this kind of this system where people can try new content,
right?
Low friction, low barrier,
yeah,
get exposed to something that is fun, creatively put together, a game I love. And then when they find, hey, I do like this, you know, Thomas was alone. I'm going to go try that game.
Yeah.
I'm going to go find other puzzle games because I found that I like it. And I don't know that that happens as much on a video service. I think it maybe happens some, but I don't know if like, you know, I don't know if all of a sudden House of Cards is popular and people go look for other political dramas or something. But right. In games, I think because of the community nature of it, because of the business model of a lot of the games and stuff, it works different than video, and it works in some very, very healthy ways.
Yeah.
Which has been awesome. So I love the discovery that happens in game paths and stuff. But Satya is a big believer. I mean, when you think about the consumer-facing businesses inside of Microsoft, the consumer products, and we do a brand analysis, what Xbox means. I mean, Xbox is a big global consumer brand in so many markets, and they love that.
It is. It's kind of amazing. We talked about, you know, you've been here at the company a long time as well as I. To remember, I always tell people the story of when we were at Millennium, which is an old office park we used to be in.
The gravel pit.
Next to a gravel pit. And I used to remind people that we would, it was the team, when I joined the team, it was like 300 people. And now I don't even know how many people are in the Xbox org around the world.
It's thousands.
It's thousands. And they're around the world. So it's growing and growing and growing. And as you just alluded to earlier, there's tremendous aspirations to go beyond the console.
There is. And the growth is part of it. I think on a percentage basis, we're one of the fastest growing groups around. Obviously, the acquisitions have a large part of that. I also, going to around the world, I love the fact that we no longer try to push everybody to live in the upper northwest corner of the United States.
Thank God,
you can go do an acquisition or hire people once you've got a footprint in different places.
Yep.
Even remote employees. I had a good lunch with one of our strong Xbox Live devs who lives in Southern California and works from his home, and he has for years.
Right.
And I think you want to find the best talent.
Right.
You want them to be able to be comfortable with where they live.
Yep.
You know, I think I was down at Brian Fargo in Exile. They're in Malibu, Newport. And then they've got another part of their studio that's over in Louisiana, the Silicon Bayou.
Yeah.
And I think it's great that we can actually have footprints, have offices in different places. It lets us hire more different kinds of people.
The talent pool is much bigger.
That's right. We're not always competing with ourselves. And it means a little more travel. But I just think as the community and the culture that we have inside of our team, it is such a great addition.
That's why I've been fighting for years. I want to get a studio out in New England where I'm from.
Yeah.
Yes, we need, you know, there used to be a couple in Boston area. But
there were, yeah.
But there's a lot of tech, a lot of students out there. I'll be going out for PAX East in a couple months. And it is amazing. How, when I was growing up, and you grew up in the Northwest.
I grew up in Southern California. Okay. And I came up here to go to this college.
But when I grew up in New England, you know, there wasn't, video games weren't a big deal. And then, of course, I moved out to Microsoft in 2000-ish. And I go back there now, and now it's like, it's everywhere.
Yeah.
And it's just, I mean, sure, you same thing. I mean, our business went from, to the point, from the 300 people on Xbox to the thousands around the world. Everybody games now.
Yeah. And that's, You look at the stats, you look at just the size of the business, the growth in the business. It is
bigger than Hollywood.
And I just say it's mainstream, right? Yeah. It is the number of people who play or watch or have interest in it. I think for us as an industry, we have to recognize that the kind of responsibility with the reach that we have now. And I think we're doing more of that. You know, I'm on the ESA board, which is the Entertainment Software Association, and Reggie's there and Sean's there and EA's there and Activision. It's like all of the main game publishers and first parties. I know Sean's doing the DICE keynote, Sean Layton from Sony this year. I got the privilege of doing that last year. And he and I had a short email exchange on like those platforms as an industry with the amount of, like, you think about how many kids on the planet, their first use of any technology is through something like Minecraft. And I'm not saying that because we own Minecraft.
Right.
Could be Minecraft on the Switch or an iPhone.
Right, whatever.
But And then, well, what does that mean? I am literally sitting in Jeff's seat today because I started playing video games with my dad, who was an engineer. And a few years into it, I wanted to figure out how these things were built.
Right.
So I learned to program.
Right.
Then I went to college and got an engineering degree because I wanted to figure out how things like that were built.
Right.
And that whole STEM path, the social impact that gaming can have, it's such a great way to bring people together in a world where a lot of things are dividing us today, where you're that and I'm a this, and there's no, there's no overlap in that. We have an art form and a society in gaming, a social that can really be, I think, an impact, have a good impact on the planet. I love that. And I love seeing the industry start to grow into that, realize that opportunity. And so many great people in the industry kind of see that and grasp that and the work that happens. And we do it in a collaborative way. Like that's, we're not competing on who's more adaptable, who's more accessible. Like let's actually be an industry that does the right thing for the as many people as we can.
Well, before you, I know you got to wrap it up in a few minutes because you need to go, but one thing I want to talk about, last year was a big year, was the adaptive controller. You kind of alluded to that a little bit. That was so huge, and we saw it in the commercial, the Microsoft with Owen over the holiday. That's what a great product that is. And I know that you get comments all the time in social, and I do it all the time in social and in person, just the difference that product made.
Yeah, the videos that we see, I mean, it's so, I had a little bit of this when we launched Kinect. Kinect was more something that I don't think we foresaw, but like autistic children who couldn't play games and were getting videos from parents who could play for the first time with their kids. And that was, I'd say, an emergent capability. This with the adaptive controller was so like a team. I mean, I think we've said this before. It started as a hackathon project.
At Microsoft.
Which, so it's not like some executive from upon high said, hey, we're going to go do this. This was community driven inside of the organization, not just people in the games team, that came together to go build this thing. And now I see the impact that that has, and kind of riding an awareness in the industry and help growing an awareness in the industry that we want everybody to play. When everybody plays, we all win. I kind of love that tagline. And I like that tagline, not as a Microsoft thing, but as an industry thing.
Yep.
The Owen commercial, the first time I saw that, it's an emotional thing. And then, you know, up on YouTube, I think they also have the backstory.
Yeah,
of Owen. That is his best friend.
Like, yeah. He's a real kid, a real story.
That's right.
Yeah.
He loves playing video games, this whole thing. Like, what do I love about
Game? He and I were trying to play over the holidays. We never connected.
Oh, that's okay.
I'll try to bring in with him.
Yeah. I just love the impact. And that is such a, I think the adaptive controller was such a great manifestation of an industry that's starting to realize its place and its capability, a team that
and responsibility
over, and responsibility, perfect word for it. And then, you know, the first thing we did when we had some early kind of working models is we sent them to a lot of different companies in the industry and we said, hey, here's whether you want to do this or you want to do something in your own skin or whatever. We think there's a real capability, and the response from the industry has been great. It's not a Microsoft thing. It's an industry thing, and it all kind of builds on itself.
And I know that you're famous. You've gone on record as famously saying, if anybody else wants to use this technology, then have at it.
That's right. And I think there's the adaptive controller, there's text-to-speech, speech-to-text work that we've been doing in games. There's just toxicity online. You know, I've obviously talked about that. It all, again, you have to come back to, are we building things that people love?
Yeah.
Like, you know, responsibility without kind of engagement from people who love what you're giving them is the most important thing. And I think 2018 was a fantastic year as an industry for just the innovation, for the art form. When you think about all of the great games that were put out, you know, Red Dead was awesome. Nintendo just had an awesome, incredible December. Sony first party has been doing a really good job. Yeah. You see third parties, you see first parties doing incredible work. We talked obviously a lot about where Sea of Thieves is and how that's grown in 2018. I think it was a real nice year for the industry to continue to push in so many fronts. And I don't see that momentum stopping, right? Yeah. Just because as I go around and talk to different publishers, different studios, it's so, people are really energized right now. There'll be natural cycles in terms of business growing, whatever. But I think that responsibility matched with the opportunity to reach so many people just has the creative community, as far as I can see it, more pumped about what they can do than ever before, which as a gamer, I'm incredibly excited.
Look back at 2018 and a kind of a preview of 2019 from Phil Spencer. Phil, thanks, man. I know you got to go. You've got a busy day today. More game? You reviewing more titles?
I am. Yeah. And like I said, maybe I'm going to sneak and finish Hellblade's Last Chapter.
Let me know if you need any help. Well, no, you have to do it. You must finish.
I'm right there. Today, every day is kind of stacked with stuff. But it's good. We're in here early in the morning.
Yeah.
And I appreciate you coming over.
Oh, my pleasure.
You beat me in today, so I came in.
Feel good about that.
And Jeff, being at Starbucks, gave me the opportunity.
In Paris, by the way.
Yeah, Starbucks in Paris. Come on, Jeff. You guys are doing a great job just staying connected with the community that we have and giving people information that they want. And I appreciate the opportunity to come on.
My pleasure, man. We'll have you on. We've also got a new episode of Inside Xbox coming up in a couple weeks. So we'll have some more.
I love Inside Xbox.
Yeah.
I watch it.
Every month.
Yeah.
Got to have you on again. We had you on in Mexico City.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
I don't think you're on this next show, but because when Phil comes on, Phil brings the heat.
Well, I see these opportunities to talk with the community, and there's things I want to talk about.
So right.
I'm probably a little less glitzy than some of your other guests, but I'm. Yeah, I appreciate it. So anytime.
Well, have some fun. All right, we'll let you go, and people can find you on social, on Twitter.
Xbox P3 or P3 on Xbox.
You're one of the four people I follow, so just follow me at Major Nelson when he's tweeting. So, all right, man, we will talk to you later. Thanks, Phil.
Thank you.